Hello everyone. So today we will learn about Carnot cycle. So before reading about Carnot cycle, let us first know about heat engine. Heat engine basically works with three components, main components, that is source, sink and working substance. This working substance may be liquid, gas or anything based on what engine we are using. So source, basically it is a hot reservoir whose heat capacity must be very high, because if the heat capacity is low, then small heat exchange will decrease the temperature, because this is at a higher temperature. So its heat capacity should be very high so that we may take large amount of heat without considerable change in temperature. So this temperature is T1 and this is a cold reservoir. Sink is a cold reservoir. And this working substance takes some Q1 heat from source. Does work. This work may be any type of work, mechanical, anything, especially mechanical work. Engine usually does a mechanical work. So it does mechanical work and releases Q2 heat to the sink. And the sink heat capacity also should be very high so that large amount of heat it can absorb without considerable change in temperature. So this is, as you can see here, cycle. This is Carnot cycle. So it was imagined by Sadi Carnot. It is an ideal engine. It was imagined. It has maximum efficiency and it is an ideal heat engine. In practical, we cannot build a Carnot engine. Till date, we cannot build. So Carnot engine was built, imagined by Sadi Carnot in 1824. He imagined four main processes that takes place in a heat engine. That is isothermal and isothermal expansion, then isentropic expansion. Adiabatic expansion is also known as isentropic expansion, because in adiabatic process entropy remains constant. So adiabatic expansion is also known as isentropic expansion. After that, isothermal compression. After that, isentropic compression. So let us calculate the efficiency of Carnot's engine. So at first, there is isothermal expansion. So first process we know is isothermal. So dT will be zero. Since dT is zero, then delta U will be also zero, because we know that internal energy of an ideal gas is varying with temperature. So since the temperature remains constant, so internal energy will also remain constant. Now let us calculate how much Q1 heat will enter here. How much heat? So let us assume it as Q1. This will be equal to the work done. Why? According to the sign convention of physics, I am taking all the sign conventions of physics, not of chemistry. In chemistry, sign conventions are different. So we know Q is equal to U plus W. So U is zero. That's why Q1 is equal to W1. So it will be equal to the work done. Now what will be the work done? Work done, since it is an isothermal process, so it will be NR T1 ln V final. What is the V final? It is V2 upon V1. So this is the first work done. First process, isothermal expansion. Now next process is adiabatic. So adiabatic expansion. Now here we know that in adiabatic process, heat exchange is zero. So here Q is zero. Now what will be the work done here? Work done in adiabatic process is NR T initial minus T final. It is actually NR T initial minus T final upon gamma minus 1. But many students write in this way also, NR T final minus T initial 1 minus gamma. So it's not necessary that we use the first one, we can use the second one also, but right now I am using the first equation here. So T initial minus T final upon gamma minus 1. Now again, isothermal compression. Next is isothermal compression. So here what happens? Again, now here it is W3. It will be again NR T2 ln V final upon V initial. What will be the V final here? V final will be this V4, V initial is V3 in this process. So V4 upon V3. We can also write it as minus NR T2 ln V3 upon V4. Why I did that? You will eventually be able to understand why I did that, because later on I will be proving that V2 upon V1 is equal to V3 upon V4. I will be proving that later on. So only for that I have done this. You can do it later on also when you prove V2 upon V1 is equal to V3 upon V4. Then also you can do that. But I am doing it right now. Okay. So yeah, I have placed this negative sign only because of that reason. Now, adiabatic compression. Again, using the same formula, NR T2 minus T1 upon gamma minus 1. Now, if we are calculating whole work done in this process, then what we get? Let me do it here. Now I am calculating total work done. That will be W1 plus W2 plus W3 plus W4. What was the first work done? NR, it was, yeah, NR T1 ln V2 upon V1 plus NR T1 minus T2 upon gamma minus 1 minus NR T2 ln, what was that? V3 upon V4 minus NR T1 minus T2 upon gamma minus 1. Now look at here, this factor cancel out. So this factor will simply cancel out. So this factor cancels out, and what we get? NR T1 ln V2 upon V1 minus NR T2 ln V3 upon V4. Now, for now, let us leave it here. We'll come back there again, but for now, let us leave. So now let us consider the adiabatic expansion in this process. Let us write, this is a reversible process, so we can use this law, that is T1 V2 gamma minus 1 is equal to T2 V3 gamma minus 1. because here the temperature is T1, here volume is V2, here temperature is T2 and volume is V3. So we can write the law here. And yeah, remember that this is not valid for irreversible adiabatic. It is only valid for reversible adiabatic. So if we are rearranging this equation, what we get it as? V2 upon V3 gamma minus 1 is power gamma minus 1 is equal to T2 upon T1. In the same way we consider this process, we are able to derive that V1 upon V4 power gamma minus 1 is equal to T2 upon T1. Now, if we simply equate these two equations, what we get? We get this. I'm writing it here. What we get is this. V1 upon V4 is equal to V2 upon V3. This is the result that we get from there. Now further simplifying it, we get V2 upon V1 is equal to V3 upon V4. I said to you that I will prove this, and hence I proved this. So this we will need later on in this equation. So this is very important relation. Now let us go back to our old equation. Now let us calculate efficiency. What is efficiency? Work input upon work done upon heat input. Work done upon heat input. So what was the work done? Work done was this. What was the heat input? Heat input was this. How did we get this equation? Look at this equation. Q1 is equal to W1. Why? I have explained that already. So we are using this equation here. So now V2 upon V1 is equal to V3 upon V4. So we are simply replacing the values, nothing else. Now you can see that this term is common. We can cancel it out. We can take it common and cancel it out. So we get this. Yeah, and this will also cancel out. This term will also cancel out. Then what we get? We get this T1 minus T2 upon T1. So 1 minus T2 upon T1. So what is the efficiency of a Carnot's engine? It is 1 minus T2 upon T1. No heat engine can have efficiency greater than that of Carnot engine. Now Carnot engine efficiency also cannot be 1. Why? For that T2 has to be 0 Kelvin, or it has to be 0 Kelvin, which is practically not possible. Or T1 has to be infinity, which is also not possible, because if T1 becomes infinity, only then we will get efficiency 1, and if T2 becomes 0 Kelvin, which is not practically possible, then we can get efficiency as 1. Since both of the cases are not practically possible, therefore Carnot engine also cannot reach the efficiency 1. I hope it is clear. Thank you.